Gorbachev and Ending the Cold War by Sanderson Beck. Gorbachev's reforms and arms race reversal. Never before has so terrible a threat hung over mankind as now. The only reasonable way out of the existing situation is the reaching of an agreement by the opposing forces on the immediate termination of the arms race, the nuclear arms race on Earth, and the prevention of arms in space. We need an agreement on an honest and equitable basis without attempts at outplaying the other side and dictating terms to it. We need an agreement which would help all to advance toward the cherished goal, the complete elimination and prohibition of nuclear weapons for all time, toward the complete removal of the threat of nuclear war. This is our firm conviction. Mikhail Gorbachev, March 11, 1985. We want freedom to reign supreme in the coming century everywhere in the world. We want peaceful competition between different social systems to develop unimpeded, to encourage mutually advantageous cooperation rather than confrontation and an arms race. We want people of every country to enjoy prosperity, welfare, and happiness. The road to this lies through proceeding to a nuclear-free, nonviolent world. We have embarked on this road and call on other countries and nations to follow suit. Mikhail Gorbachev, Perestroika. Mikhail Gorbachev was born on March 2, 1931, during a famine on the Stavropol steppe. He was active in the Young Communist League, then in Komsomol, and joined the Communist Party in 1952. He studied law at Moscow State University, graduating at the same time as his wife Raisa in 1955. The next year, Gorbachev became first secretary of the Komsomol in Stavropol, and he continued to rise in the government. In 1964, his mentor, Kulikov, became head of the Agriculture Department on the Central Committee. And 3 years later, Gorbachev earned his degree from the Stavropol Agricultural Institute. In 1970, he was elected first secretary of the Stavropol Krai Party and was promoted to the Central Committee. Raisa had studied the self-accounting system used in Krasnodar that gave people cash incentives for larger harvests, and her husband gained attention for the success of the new Ipatovsky harvesting methods. When Kulikov died in 1978, Gorbachev became Secretary of Agriculture and moved to Moscow. 2 years later, he became a voting member of the elite Politburo. In 1982, his patron, KGB Chief Yuri Andropov, became General Secretary. While Andropov was dying, Gorbachev was his main link to the party elite. When Soviet jets shot down the straying Korean Airlines Flight 007, Gorbachev headed the crisis management team. In 1984, Konstantin Chernenko became general secretary, but he was ailing too, and as his second, Gorbachev presided over meetings. In December 1984, Gorbachev went to England and met with Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher. He hoped that with her help, he could persuade President Reagan to agree to free Western Europe of U.S. missiles and not go forward on his Strategic Defense Initiative, SDI, or Star Wars. Gorbachev complained about the folly of the nuclear arms race and challenged Britain's acquiescence to U.S. missiles in Europe. He asked for her suggestions on how he might decentralize the Soviet economy, and wanted to learn how Britain had adjusted to the transformation of its empire to a commonwealth. Afterward, Thatcher announced, "I like Mr. Gorbachev. We can do business together." On March 10, 1985, Chernenko died, and Mikhail Gorbachev became the leader of the Soviet Union. The very next day, he called for an end to the arms race and for the complete abolition of nuclear weapons. He proposed freezing nuclear arsenals and stopping further deployment of missiles as steps leading to a substantial reduction of the stockpiles, and he warned against developing new weapons in space or on Earth. Gorbachev wanted to improve the inefficient Soviet economy and brought Boris Yeltsin from Sverdlovsk to head the Moscow Party. He moved aside the aging foreign minister, Andrei Gromyko, by giving him a ceremonial position as Soviet president, appointing Eduard Shevardnadze from Georgia. A more hidden advisor was the bold intellectual Alexander Yakovlev. In April, Gorbachev began to discuss restructuring perestroika, the economy, by using flexible cost accounting and retooling. Because the enormous consumption of vodka had been weakening the economy and culture, Gorbachev decreed fines and punishments for being drunk in public, introduced treatment programs, and restricted the sale of alcohol, raising the drinking age from 18 to 21. He courted the intellectuals by encouraging writers, such as Vitaly Korotich, whom he made editor of Ogonyok, Little Flame. Gorbachev and Yakovlev wanted the press and literature to help people to understand they could express their own power. Gorbachev began cutting back the military by making officers retire, and he was the first Soviet leader to take personal control over the nuclear weapons. In April, he announced that he was suspending the deployment of the Soviet SS-20 missiles in Europe. He announced a unilateral moratorium on nuclear testing in July, began making proposals for cutting the large numbers of strategic weapons in half, and for the first time opened Soviet military installations to verification of disarmament treaties. He wanted to keep the commitment of the Non-Proliferation Treaty by halting and reversing the nuclear arms race. In September 1985, Gorbachev met with President Ronald Reagan at Geneva. He quoted Reagan's famous statement, "A nuclear war could never be won and must never be fought," and then asked why both nations were building new weapons when they were never even going to use the ones they already had. In January 1986, Gorbachev proposed the complete elimination of all nuclear weapons by the year 2000. The next month, the political prisoner, Anatoly Sharansky, was freed and allowed to leave the Soviet Union in a spy exchange. During a satellite broadcast in August 1986, Gorbachev accused Reagan of escalating the arms race in order to exhaust the Soviet economy, imposing hardships on people. He announced that the Soviet Union would extend its unilateral moratorium on nuclear testing for another 6 months. Also in 1986, Gorbachev proposed withdrawing 7,000 troops from Afghanistan, and he planned to start converting defense industries to produce consumer goods. On April 26, 1986, the worst nuclear power disaster in history so far occurred when the plant at Chernobyl exploded and caused much radioactive poisoning. Gorbachev was troubled by international criticism but took control of the bureaucratic ineptness. He learned that several other plants were also in danger, and he made experts sign papers that they would be responsible for fixing them. As a result, he had the plant in Armenia shut down, and five others were ordered to stop operating. Gorbachev urged historians to report on the extensive horrors of the Stalin era so that they could understand their own past and learn. Gorbachev and Reagan met again in October 1986 at Reykjavik, Iceland. Gorbachev proposed eliminating all strategic nuclear weapons by 1996 and insisted that the Strategic Defense Initiative, SDI, be delayed for 10 years. Never before had superpower leaders even discussed reducing their nuclear arsenals. In private, he even seems to have persuaded the U.S. president, but Reagan's advisors did not agree because of the Star Wars program. At the press conference, Gorbachev said that SDI did not scare them and that their response would be asymmetrical and would not cost as much. He warned that if they attacked the constraints of the anti-ballistic missile ABM treaty, they would be worthless politicians. In December 1986, Gorbachev called Andrei Sakharov to tell him he could return to Moscow. Gorbachev would not immediately agree to free all the prisoners, but in the next 3 months, about 300 political prisoners were released. He initiated his democratization campaign at the beginning of 1987. He realized that it would be a good and bad process of dialectic, but he declared that is real life. We must learn from the mistakes and go forward. Publication of Pasternak's Dr. Zhivago was allowed, and Gorbachev had the moving anti-Stalin film Repentance shown on television. Russian broadcasts by the BBC and Voice of America were no longer jammed. In March 1987, Margaret Thatcher visited Gorbachev in Moscow. He asked her what world opinion would think if the Soviets removed their medium-range missiles from Europe and reduced their strategic weapons by half while she continued building up her forces. He condemned the Brezhnev Doctrine and called the Iron Curtain archaic, suggesting that his policy toward Eastern Europe would be more liberal. The next month, Gorbachev traveled to Prague and began implying that these countries could be independent, indicating his sympathy for the Dubček reforms. In July, Gorbachev proposed the elimination of all intermediate-range nuclear missiles in the world. Gorbachev got his reform program enacted into law by the Supreme Soviet in June 1987 to begin decentralizing the economy by some experimentation with free markets, letting the nation's 50,000 businesses reorganize themselves under their own management and allowing them to make a profit or go out of business. However, the top party administrators persuaded him to let them have 7 years to make the transition, enabling them to get around many of the new laws. Gorbachev went into seclusion for 52 days during the summer of 1987, and in the fall he published his book, Perestroika. He called for new thinking and tried to find a synthesis of what worked in other countries, production in the United States, labor management relations in Japan, and the social solutions of Sweden. A totalitarian bureaucracy was falling apart as the democratic politics brought criticisms and reforms. The outspoken Yeltsin became a rival and advocated taking on the bureaucracy directly. Gorbachev visited Washington in December 1987, and the two superpower leaders agreed on the Intermediate Nuclear Forces, INF, treaty that would eliminate two categories of nuclear weapons. Reagan lectured the Soviet leader on human rights and challenged him to open up his society to allow free ideas and travel. Gorbachev restrained his temper, but privately, he told his advisors to commit the Soviet Union to human rights reform. As in Iceland, greater strategic reductions were blocked at the last moment because of a disagreement on SDI and the interpretation of the anti-ballistic missile ABM treaty. In February 1988, Gorbachev announced that all Soviet troops would be withdrawn from Afghanistan, and this was completed 1 year later. In April, this process began, and the USSR and the U.S. both pledged not to interfere in the internal affairs of Afghanistan and Pakistan. In March 1988, conservative communists led by Yegor Ligachev tried to overthrow Gorbachev, who was able to fragment them and isolate Ligachev in order to lessen his power. Generally, the Soviet economy was still in a mess, although some reforms using private enterprise and cooperatives created more wealth. But these tended to be in services such as restaurants rather than in industry. Glasnost had opened the floodgates on much pent-up criticism. Gorbachev gradually developed perestroika from restructuring of the economy into a larger moral reform and psychological empowerment. At the party conference in June, Gorbachev proposed increasing local power and forming a new parliament called the Congress of People's Deputies. In October, Gorbachev was elected to replace Gromyko as president of the Supreme Soviet. Gorbachev made an important speech to the United Nations in December 1988. He described his vision for a new era that would leave the Cold War behind. As a Christmas gift, he announced that the Soviet Union was going to reduce its military forces by 500,000 men by the end of 1990. 6 tank divisions would be withdrawn from Czechoslovakia, Hungary, and East Germany and be disbanded by 1991. He called for a new world order and renounced the use of force. The next day, he promised that the Soviet Union would reform its laws to conform to the International Human Rights Convention that had been signed at Helsinki in 1975. The Soviet Union had lost more than 50,000 men in the costly Afghanistan War, and for the first time since Soviet troops had left Austria in 1955, they would withdraw from a nation they had conquered. Unlike American presidents in their attitude toward Vietnam, Gorbachev would later admit that the Afghanistan War was morally wrong and a crime against humanity. Polls of Europeans showed that he was twice as popular as Reagan. Liberation of Eastern Europe, 1989 to 91. Freedom and democracy, after all, mean joint participation and shared responsibility. Your government, my people, has returned to you. Václav Havel, January 1, 1990. We need a new system of values, a system of the organic unity between mankind and nature, and the ethic of global responsibility. Mikhail Gorbachev. The leadership of János Kádár allowed some reforms in Hungary and free travel, and as a result, living standards in Hungary were rising. In 1987, some young communist academics wrote Turn and Reform, calling for the government to dialogue with the people on reforms. In the following year, Kádár and others were replaced by reformers. The Hungarians had learned from their failed uprising of 1956. And the Democratic Forum was committed to nonviolence. In March 1989, at Budapest, 75,000 people were allowed to demonstrate without being disrupted by the police. That month, the Soviet Union Army stopped drafting university students. The anti-religious edicts of the 1960s were rescinded. In April, the Polish government legalized the Solidarity Union and agreed to elections. By staying nonviolent, Solidarity could now engage in a dialogue with the communist leaders in a roundtable discussion. After the Soviet Army suppressed a demonstration at Tbilisi, killing at least 20 people and wounding hundreds, the leader of the Communist Party in Georgia was replaced. 74 communist members of the Soviet Union Central Committee were also removed on the same day. Soviet troops began leaving Hungary. In May, the Hungarian government gave up party control of the Interior Ministry for a multi-party system and began removing the electrified fence on its Austrian border. By September, the border was opened and thousands of East Germans started going west. Gorbachev visited China for 5 days in May to normalize relations, sparking the students' democracy demonstrations. While he was there, Lithuania and Estonia passed legislation declaring their sovereignty, followed by Latvia in July. The Soviet Union voted to elect 2,250 members of the People's Deputies. Though about a third were selected by party organizations, many new voices were elected directly by the people. On May 25th, at the first session of the Congress of People's Deputies, Gorbachev was elected President of the Soviet Union. On June 4, 1989, Solidarity won every open election in Poland except for one. Meanwhile, ethnic riots in Uzbekistan killed scores of people. On the 1st of July, Gorbachev went on television to warn people about ethnic conflict. 5 days later, in Strasbourg, he pledged that the USSR would not block reforms in Eastern Europe. And the next day, he announced at Bucharest that the Warsaw Pact nations were free to choose their own paths to socialism. At home, Gorbachev's liberalization was doing more for the intelligentsia than for the workers. In July, about 2 million suffering coal miners went on strike all across Siberia. Though on television, he announced his support of the striking miners. In August, Gorbachev called Rakowski, the leader of Poland's Communist Party, and urged him to let Solidarity help lead the government. 2 days later, for the first time, a Communist Party was voted out of power as Tadeusz Mazowiecki was elected Prime Minister of Poland. By early October, people were leaving East Germany at the rate of 200 per hour. 2,500 East Germans had taken refuge at the West Germany Embassy in Prague, and Erich Honecker agreed to let them pass through East Germany to the West. But on October 4th, when he directed their train through Dresden, thousands tried to board the train and were brutally beaten by police, as 1,300 were arrested. Dresden's party leader, Modrow, was soon leading the large demonstrations there. 3 days later, the visiting Gorby was cheered in East Berlin when he announced that political decisions for the German Democratic Republic were decided in Berlin, not in Moscow. The unpopular Honecker had ordered German police to club demonstrators, but a few days later, he resigned. The Hungarian Communist Party changed its name to the Socialist Party, and the parliament planned multi-party elections. Hungarians rallied on the 23rd anniversary of the 1956 uprising, and on October 24th, hundreds of thousands of Hungarians non-violently overthrew their communist government and proclaimed a republic. At Warsaw, 3 days later, the Warsaw Pact nations announced their decision allowing each nation the right to choose its own course and prohibiting any intervention of one member in the affairs of another. In early November, Honecker's successor, Egon Krenz, opened the border to the west, and East Germans began rushing through the opening in the Berlin Wall. In Bulgaria, hardline communist leaders were removed. In Czechoslovakia in 1977, playwright Václav Havel and other intellectuals had formed Charter 77 as an informal community to honor respect for human rights. They were committed to nonviolent and legal methods and tried to engage the authorities in dialogue. Yet in 1979, Havel was imprisoned for 4 years for having stood with people who laid flowers by a statue in Wenceslas Square. After he was released, Havel inspired many with his long essay, The Power of the Powerless. Authorities arrested dissidents on October 28th, but Gorbachev urged them to allow change. On November 17, 1989, a rally of 15,000 in Prague formed the Civic Forum, but student demonstrators were beaten by police. More than 100 were arrested and 561 were injured. Over the weekend, the first student strike committee was organized as Havel and other Civic Forum leaders directed a nonviolent revolution. On November 22nd, leaders of Civic Forum's sister organization, Public Against Violence, spoke to 100,000 people in Slovakia's capital at Bratislava. The next day, 300,000 people gathered during very cold weather in Wenceslas Square in Prague as Czech television employees voted to give full coverage to the demonstrations. A general strike was called for November 27th and was observed by 80% of the workers. The next day, Havel met with Vladislav Adamek, who agreed to a new federal government. The day after that, the Federal Assembly ended political domination by the Communist Party. When Alexander Dubček spoke to a gathering of 250,000 people, the communist leaders resigned. Even in Russia, the 72nd anniversary of the Soviet Union on November 7th turned into a protest of communism by 5,000 students. the Supreme Soviet of Georgia declared its sovereignty. Gorbachev loved change and said Europe must advance even faster toward a commonwealth of sovereign democratic states. He visited the Pope in Rome and announced a new law respecting freedom of religion. Old Russian churches became popular again, and in Central Asia, mosques began to reopen. The Supreme Soviet passed a law banning censorship of the media and another law that gave the Baltic republics some economic autonomy. At Malta in early December 1989, Gorbachev met U.S. President George Bush and pledged he would not use force to prop up communist regimes in Eastern Europe. Bush agreed to cancel most prohibitions against U.S. trade with the liberalizing Soviet Union. The Bush administration had been concerned that the charismatic Gorbachev had taken advantage of Reagan, and they had spent a year reviewing their policy. In East Germany, the Central Committee, Egon Krenz, and the ruling Politburo all resigned on December 3rd, and a week later, President Gustav Husák of Czechoslovakia resigned as non-communists took over the government in Prague. Romania was the only country that used violence to overthrow its communist rulers. Riots began breaking out, and on December 25th, the dictatorial Nicolae Ceaușescu and his wife were convicted by a military tribunal of murdering 60,000 people during their rule. They were executed by a firing squad. 4 days later, playwright Václav Havel was inaugurated as president of Czechoslovakia as Dubček became chairman of the Czechoslovak parliament. The accelerated pace of these revolutions was indicated by some who said that they took 10 years in Poland, 10 months in Hungary, 10 weeks in East Germany, 10 days in Czechoslovakia, and 10 hours in Romania. In January 1990, Soviet troops were sent to quell riots in Azerbaijan near the Iranian border. When Gorbachev visited Vilnius, 250,000 Lithuanians rallied for independence on January 11th. On the same day, Armenia declared its right to veto Soviet laws. After conflicts between Armenia and Azerbaijan killed 30 people, the Soviet army occupied Baku, taking 60 lives before order was restored. In February, Gorbachev negotiated a deal with West German Chancellor Helmut Kohl, whereby a reunified Germany could remain in NATO if its united forces were smaller than those of West Germany alone had been. Gorbachev promised to withdraw Soviet troops within 3 or 4 years, and he hoped that the United States would withdraw its forces too. In exchange, Germany would give the Soviet Union economic assistance and greater cooperation in all areas. The nuclear arms race had also cost the United States, which was suffering a recession and had become the world's largest debtor. Glasnost had allowed national and ethnic conflicts to be expressed. Gorbachev hoped to keep the Union together in a constitutional federation, but secession fever was spreading. He advised the Communist Party to allow multi-party elections, and many opponents won places on local councils, Soviets. On February 27th, Gorbachev got the Supreme Soviet to increase his presidential powers on the same day the Congress of People's Deputies nullified Article 6 of the Constitution that had given the Communist Party dominant control. On March 11th, Lithuania declared its independence and elected Landsbergis president, though Gorbachev called Lithuania's action illegal and invalid. 4 days later, Gorbachev was re-elected president of the Soviet Union with 59% of the deputies' votes. The next election in 1995 would be by popular vote. Gorbachev excluded the use of military forces outside of the Soviet Union, with the only exception being after a sudden attack from outside. He appointed Yakovlev head of his presidential council with authority over the KGB and other security. This ended the investigation whether Gorbachev had taken bribes while he was in Stavropol. Lithuanians were not intimidated by the Soviet army and refused conscription, holding to their right by international law to secede. In April, Gorbachev shut down oil and gas lines to Lithuania. In 1990, Gorbachev was being severely criticized by conservative communists for destroying the old system and by the liberal progressives like Yeltsin for not freeing the economy and expression even more. Gorbachev still would not allow undesirables to speak on television or radio stations or publish in newspapers he controlled. He had tried to reform much of the corruption, but had maintained his luxurious perks. At party meetings, furious debates took place, and Gorbachev often became angry with those he called adventurers. He was trying to ride the tiger of revolution he had unleashed, and getting the conservatives and progressives to work together became increasingly difficult. Gorbachev still believed in socialism and was not willing to take one side or the other. Under communism, the state socialism had become very corrupt with bribes of bureaucrats and a legal system that seldom provided justice because of organized crime. Ironically, freeing the economy tended to increase this corruption as the black market was legalized. Shifting toward a more capitalistic system gave great advantages to those already in positions of power. The gross domestic product of the Soviet Union was now declining 10% a year, and crime was increasing. Radicals had won many elections, and at the May Day parade, protesters chanted that Gorbachev should resign. He issued a presidential decree banning demonstrations in central Moscow, and he pushed through a law making it a crime to damage the honor and dignity of the newly created Soviet president. At the end of May, the price of bread was to be tripled, and panicking buyers emptied the markets. Gorbachev opposed Yeltsin, who won a close vote to become the president of Russia's parliament. In June, they proclaimed that Russia's laws were sovereign over those of the Soviet Union. In July, Yeltsin resigned from the Communist Party, and Gorbachev decreed the end of party control over the media and approved Yeltsin's 500-day plan for a market economy. The Ukraine and Belarusia declared their sovereignty, followed in August by Armenia, Turkmenistan, and Tajikistan. In September, the Soviet Union agreed to friendship treaties recognizing the reunification of Germany, ending the authority by the four powers, U.S., Britain, France, and USSR, in Germany. That month, the Supreme Soviet gave Gorbachev special powers for the transition to a market economy. In October 1990, mass demonstrations in the Ukraine led to the resignation of Prime Minister Vitaly Mosel. That month, the United States and the Soviet Union agreed to a treaty on conventional forces in Europe and for reducing greatly their nuclear arsenals. Gorbachev was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. He devalued the ruble and announced that foreigners could now own Soviet enterprises. Nationalists defeated the communists in the Republic of Georgia. Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan declared their sovereignty. In November, Gorbachev promised the military that he would preserve the country's unity and warned that disintegration would mean a bloodbath. 4 days later, the Supreme Soviet approved a Federation Council that would include the leaders of the 15 republics. The next week, the name of the country was changed to the Union of Sovereign Socialist Republics. Gorbachev barred the republics from controlling nuclear weapons in their territories and authorized soldiers to use force if they were harassed. In December, the Russian parliament legalized private ownership of land, and Lech Wałęsa was elected president of Poland. Fearing a coming dictatorship, Foreign Minister Shevardnadze resigned. 3 days later, KGB head Kryuchkov warned that violence may be necessary to restore order, as he accused the CIA of fomenting dissent in the USSR. In January 1991, Soviet troops began seizing media outlets in Lithuania and used force to quell demonstrations opposing this. Gorbachev said he had not ordered it, but approved nonetheless, causing many intellectuals to withdraw their support from Gorbachev. In response, the European Parliament voted to withhold $1 billion worth of food aid. In February, Yeltsin called for Gorbachev's resignation, and strikes by coal miners spread. The next month, troops were brought into Moscow, but were unable to stop a large Yeltsin demonstration. The Warsaw Pact was officially dissolved. The Russian Supreme Soviet gave Yeltsin greater powers. Strikes began in Minsk, and Georgia declared independence. In June, Yeltsin was elected president of Russia with 57% of the votes. In July, the USSR Supreme Soviet approved the idea of a union treaty but suggested changes, and Gorbachev was unable to get much economic assistance from the Capitalist Group of Seven meeting at London. On August 17, 1991, Kryuchkov, Pavlov, and Yazov demanded that Gorbachev relinquish power to them. When Gorbachev refused to order a crackdown the next day, Vice President Yanayev claimed presidential powers. The day after that, an emergency committee assumed power, but Yeltsin declared the coup illegal. On August 21st, the coup failed, and Gorbachev returned to Moscow. No longer believing that the Communist Party could be reformed, 3 days later he suspended the Communist Party and resigned as General Secretary. Now Gorbachev could see no other way but democracy. In the next week, the Ukraine, Belarus, Byelorussia, Moldova, Azerbaijan, Uzbekistan, and Kyrgyzstan all proclaimed their independence. On September 6, Georgia broke free of the USSR, whose council that day recognized the independence of Estonia, Latvia, and Lithuania, supporting their membership in the United Nations. Residents of Leningrad voted to change the name of their city back to St. Petersburg, and Tajikistan and Armenia declared their independence. In October, the Russian Congress gave Yeltsin power to implement economic reforms by decree, and the next month he banned the Communist Party. Yeltsin and leaders of the other republics in the USSR State Council agreed on a new confederation. In December, the Ukraine voted to be independent and elected Leonid Kravchuk president. A week later, Yeltsin, Kravchuk, and the Belarusian chief of state, Shushkevich, met and decided to replace the Soviet Union with a Commonwealth of Independent States, CIS. 2 days later, Belarus and the Ukraine ratified the CIS agreement, followed the next day by the Russian parliament. Central Asian leaders met in Ashgabat the day after that and requested membership in the CIS. By December 22nd, the leaders of 11 republics, all except Georgia, signed the Commonwealth Declaration, and 3 days later, Gorbachev resigned on television as the Russian flag replaced the Soviet flag over the Kremlin. Gorbachev and the Earth Charter. On April 20, 1993, at the Global Forum in Kyoto, Gorbachev announced the birth of Green Cross International, 9 months after it had been conceived at the Rio Summit in order to help sustain and manage life on planet Earth. He noted that the environmental movement usually focuses on local threats, but he warned that global problems such as the greenhouse effect required urgent action. He called for the united efforts of natural and social scientists to work for human survival. He suggested that state self-determination needs to be harmonized with the principles of international relations. He noted that the end of the Cold War had not ended the conflicts between nations, and that the growth of freedom did not automatically bring a growth in morality. He recommended an ecology of spirit and a moral strengthening of humanism. Human pride and passion must be curbed by a philosophy of limits, for plundering nature is stealing from ourselves. The civilization of the future must be planetary with high diversity. He urged research and international cooperation. The Earth Charter Initiative was begun by Earth Council Chairman Maurice Strong and Gorbachev in 1994 in order to implement the action plan of the 1992 Earth Summit at Rio de Janeiro. The first international workshop was held at The Hague in May 1995 with representatives from 30 countries and 70 organizations. A commission of 23 people issued a draft Earth Charter at the Rio Plus 5 Forum in March 1997. The consultation process continued for two more years, and in April 1999, the Earth Charter Benchmark Draft 2 was issued. The mission of the Earth Charter was officially launched in June 2000 at The Hague, to establish a sound ethical foundation for the emerging global society and to help build a sustainable world based on respect for nature, universal human rights, economic justice, and a culture of peace. In 2002, the Earth Charter was recognized by the United Nations, and many countries and organizations have adopted it as an educational tool. The main principles of the Earth Charter are the following. 1. Respect and care for the community of life. 1. Respect Earth and life in all its diversity. 2. Care for the community of life with understanding, compassion, and love. 3. Build democratic societies that are just, participatory, sustainable, and peaceful. 4. Secure Earth's bounty and beauty for present and future generations. 2. Ecological integrity. 5. Protect and restore the integrity of Earth's ecological systems, with special concern for biological diversity and the natural processes that sustain life. 6. Prevent harm as the best method of environmental protection, and when knowledge is limited, apply a precautionary approach. 7. Adopt patterns of production, consumption, and reproduction that safeguard Earth's regenerative capacities, human rights, and community well-being. 8. Advance the study of ecological sustainability and promote the open exchange and wide application of the knowledge acquired. 3. Social and economic justice. 9. Eradicate poverty as an ethical, social, and environmental imperative. 10. Ensure that economic activities and institutions at all levels promote human development in an equitable and sustainable manner. 11. Affirm gender equality and equity as prerequisites to sustainable development and ensure universal access to education, healthcare, and economic opportunity. 12. Uphold the right of all, without discrimination, to a natural and social environment supportive of human dignity, bodily health, and spiritual well-being, with special attention to the rights of indigenous peoples and minorities. 4. Democracy, nonviolence, and peace. 13. Strengthen democratic institutions at all levels and provide transparency and accountability in governance, inclusive participation in decision-making, and access to justice. 14. Integrate into formal education and lifelong learning the knowledge, values, and skills needed for a sustainable way of life. 15. Treat all living beings with respect and consideration. 16. Promote a culture of tolerance, nonviolence, and peace. Gorbachev attended the Third Global Summit of Nobel Peace Laureates in October 2002, and in their final statement, they lamented that the United Nations World Summit on Sustainable Development in Johannesburg the previous month had not addressed such fundamental problems as poverty, environmental degradation, and the increasingly acute energy crisis. the participants declared that unilateral action against Iraq was unacceptable, and they supported the Water for Peace initiative of Green Cross International to resolve the global water crisis.